Blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. James chapter 1, verse 12, your fellow redeemed. When it is all falling apart, when you really look at your life and you say, it got off track. This is off track. This isn't where I thought it would be. When you can't even point to a moment where sometimes we think we can look at a particular moment and say, right there, that's when it all went wrong, and this is what started the thing from the path it was on going in the wrong direction. When you come to the realization that you have absolutely zero control, we have way, way less control over things than we can even possibly imagine. God has a very powerful message for you. A very powerful, clear message. He says, trust me, lean on me, depend on me, I will see you through. And so the book of Job has brought incredible comfort to many that have endured difficulties and hardships and struggles. Yet I would venture this for you, that perhaps the greatest strength, not that it's not a great strength, in that while you struggle, the book of Job, the Lord works powerfully through. I believe that it does. But I would say the greatest strength of Job is not while you are struggling. The greatest strength of Job is that you learn it, you meditate it. Luther once said, read the word, meditate on the word, and then suffer. This will get you closer to God. I believe Job then, its greatest strength is to read before you suffer. Know the book of Job before, so that when those hardship days come, you are better prepared. So this morning we're going to consider Job in many ways. It presents this incredibly powerful theme. And in the theme, it begins really with that moment when Satan appears before the Lord. Satan appears before the Lord. The Lord calls out to Satan, saying, have you considered Job my servant? The Lord says that Job is righteous. Now don't get all wild here. When the Bible's talking about righteous, what the Lord is saying is not that he's a sinless person. There's no Hebrew expression for him being sinless, for anyone being sinless other than Jesus. No, when the Bible's talking about righteous here with Job, it's expressing that he's complete, in that Job is as good as possible as a fallen man can be. This anger is Satan. So Satan charges against God. Satan is angered on many levels, one of which being Satan can't understand true love. And we'll talk about that in a few minutes. But Satan is upset about this. He says that, you know, God, you've created a system. You've created a system in which if somebody does what you say, walks along in you, they will directly benefit because of that. If they do thing one here, you will do thing two here, and they'll be happy with thing three. In other words, anybody, including Job, only follows you, only trusts in you, only walks in you to get stuff because it's profitable for them individually, selfishly, and personally to believe, to walk in, and trust in you. In other words, Satan is saying, they're serving themselves through you, God. That's what you created. So then Satan floats out the idea. If you would remove the blessings from Job, Job will curse you and walk away from you, as would anybody. At the same time, you have to admit that what's being dealt with in the book of Job is the popular thinking of that day, and certainly our day right now, which is, God, if I'm good, you will bless me. God, if I behave right, you will reward me accordingly. But if I'm bad, then you will punish me. This is how this works. This is how this God thing works. Well, the book of Job answers so many questions, doesn't it? It asks the question. It answers the question. It asks the question, does Job really just serve God because of what he can get out of it? It asks the question, when things are difficult, when it's hard to follow God, when it seems like everything is falling apart and God has seemingly abandoned you, why would you stick with him? Job asks and answers that question as well. And so it seems, at first, that perhaps the book of Job is showing us that Job's faith in God is what's on trial. That Job is, in many ways, the main character. And we're watching this develop. But to think that would actually be off. It's not Job that's on trial in the book of Job, it's God. God is center stage. God's the one on trial. Satan is challenging and making the charges against God. He's saying, God, if you're so loving, if you're so purposing in the lives of all people, using all things for your children to work together for good, then let's see it. Because they're not going to go with you unless you do what they want you to do. Now, one thing the book of Job doesn't do is it doesn't tell you, and you will never necessarily know this in life, why all of what happens to you happens to you. But it points you to Jesus. And the book of Job debunks this very faulty and unbiblical idea about suffering and about suffering always being directly related to something that we've done in our life, or that it's just so random, nobody has control over these things. Life is far more complicated than that. You know that. And so the book of Job prepares us and readies us for those hard times. With that in mind, then, I'd like to invite your attention to these selected portions of the book of Job. We're going to look at two portions from chapter 1, and we're going to jump to chapter 19. There was a man in the land of Oz whose name was Job, and that man was blameless and upright and one who feared God and shunned evil. And 7 sons and 3 daughters were born to him. Also his possessions were 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and a very large household. So that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East, and none. So Satan answered the Lord and said, "Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him, around his household, and around all that he has on every side? You've blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But now stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." And then after all that happened to Job, happened here in the middle of that, chapter 19, Job speaks, "I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh, I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I, and not another, how my heart yearns within me." These are the verbally inspired words of our God. By them we seek to be refreshed, refocused, and strengthened, especially when we deal with the hard times that we encounter in this life that are so much of living in a sinful world. That God would grant us such blessings and such gifts through the power of the Spirit working his word to that we pray. Sanctify us by your truth, O Lord. Your word is true. Amen. In all of the books of the Bible, Job is truly remarkable. On so many levels, this book is absolutely incredible. We don't even know the time period set in. Some think that its time period is set in the days of Abraham going that far back. Others say, no, it's probably more in line with the time of King Solomon. But either way, we don't know, and it doesn't even matter. Job was not a descendant of Abraham. He was a man apart, a Gentile. And in the book of Job, we encounter this very real man facing very real issues and situations that people face in life. The book breaks down into 4 incredible stages. Stage 1, chapter 1 and 2, is sort of a behind-the-scenes peek. You go behind the curtain, you see something that, for the most part, we don't think Job ever knows. This conversation between God and Satan. Then chapters 3 through 37 pick up on the calamities that hit Job, the loss of his fortune, the loss of his family, the loss of his own health. And then in chapter 38 through 41, God speaks to Job. He doesn't tell him why, what's going on, not at all. But God speaks directly to Job. And then the last few verses of chapter 41 are sort of an epilogue that kind of show you, here's how it all ends. Many lessons, huge lessons for our lives. Especially the one that most rally around when it comes to the book of Job, and it is worthy to rally around this one, which is handling suffering. Dealing with difficulties, troubles, trials, and temptations in life. God doesn't always tell us why. The book of Job makes that so clear. And yes, we have to admit, there are times we do something foolish and we directly bear the consequences of that. We feel the results of that. That's true, that does happen, but that's not what Job's talking about. Job is addressing the hardships, the struggles that are, they're beyond your control. You think of things like sickness, persistent sickness or terminal illness. You think of any kind of economic or natural disaster. You think of just destructions in relationships. Think of whatever it is that hurts us that you can't put your hands on. You can't even come close. And so we see Satan take aim at Job. We learn this throughout the whole book. You learn that Satan will always hang himself with his own rope. In that Satan brings about pain and damage and hurt, and what Satan wants is for you to be destroyed. He doesn't care about your physical destruction. He has one major goal, to destroy your relationship from God, to break your trust in him. But what Job teaches us, and this is the Bible truth, the Bible is so consistent on this point, is that Satan can only and ever cause enough damage in your life to drive you closer to God, to drive you deeper into him, to lead you to this incredible realization of how much you are loved and you are valued by your Savior. So it all begins. The book of Job begins with Satan. He's boasting to God. God is calling out to him. God is holding the audience. Satan's no equal. He's so far below God. Luther said rightly, one little word can fell him. But Satan boasts to God. He says this, verse 9. Does Job fear you for nothing? Satan is saying, I know why he loves you, or whatever love is. I know what it is. It's personal profit. It's personal benefiting. He says, have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? Now, of course, many here, they take this and they make the argument, which I think is a pretty strong argument, saying Satan has no idea what real love is, which I believe is true. He can't fathom love. He has no clue. He can't understand love. He doesn't understand what it is that in love you give. When you really love someone, you open yourself up to that person and you know that it's costly. You know that there is a great expense on your end and you don't care. You're going to pay it because you love that person. You're going to lift that person up and hold them before you. Because this isn't self-centered. This isn't self-motivated. This is looking to them and not asking for your own return because you're saying, I love you, I value you, I honor you. Love goes forth and it goes out. It doesn't expect to get in return. Job loved God, not for what God could do for him, but because who God is. Job loved God because God first loved him, and Satan can't stand it. Satan, from all looks of it, views love as the business contract. You do this, you do that. If you do these sorts of things, if you do your end, God, I'll do my end, God, and we'll all be happy and get along and live together. You have to agree, Satan isn't far off, is he? Many view God that way. They view their relationship with God. They say, Jesus, I will follow you. I will profess you. You can be Savior, King, God, whatever, as long as I get mine. When I get what I want, when I get what I think I need. But if I don't get what I want, as soon as my agenda is interrupted or it doesn't look like it's ever going to happen, I'm gone. And then God is charged with being uncaring, unloving, unconcerned, unfair, and ultimately abandoned. But what you see is Satan was way wrong. And he does not understand love whatsoever. You see, God, as we see, chapters 1 and 2, he allows Satan to rain down on Job. Now I want you to notice something here. It is not God who rains down on Job. God doesn't make the disasters strike his family for his wealth. God doesn't lead the raiding parties to slaughter Job's children. God doesn't make death. The forces of darkness that were unleashed when our first parents walked away from God, when our first parents rebelled against God, they brought tragedy, they brought separation, they brought death into this world. Yet, the book of Job lays this in front of you. God is in supreme control over everything. God rules over everything. He sets the limits on evil. God dictates the terms. You will go no farther than what I say, because God rules over everything. He may permit for a time the affliction to strike. He gives it a certain extent that it has to stay into. So God allows, but God only and ever allows this evil to happen to the point that it accomplishes the very opposite of the purpose that Satan is seeking to accomplish. Remember, Satan's goal is when you suffer to drive you away from God, to create huge distances between you and God so that you finally walk away with him in anger, disillusionment, that your trust and your faith is broken. But know this, God controls the situation. God, not Satan, controls the situation. He will only allow it to hit you in so much as the suffering makes you stronger. Now please don't think this is some nonsensical, no pain, no gain thing. Please. We're talking about Jesus here. We're talking about the Father. The Father in heaven who refines us through fire. The Father in heaven who is the perfect gardener who prunes things out of our lives. The loving Father that disciplines us that we may be his children and walk in his ways. And so the Bible lays out in front of us very, very difficult truths at times. Such difficult truths can be found when Paul writes to the church in Corinth and says, "No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, he provides also the way of escape in that you may endure it." So Job initially, how remarkable. Chapter 1, Job initially loses it all, we could say. And here's his response. "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." And all of this, Job did not sin by charging God with wrongdoing. But you see, it lingered on. And sometimes it's the hardest part. Quick pain, quick trial, no matter how hard it is, sometimes seems better than a lingering one. And it lingered here. And so, throughout the body of the book, we encounter the friends of Job. And they're a great conversation to have. Job's friends come and they show strong, incredible friendship. In fact, the whole middle part is pretty much dialogue between Job and wife and Job and three friends. So they're dialoguing, but at first, his friends are supporting him, they're sitting with him, they're showing love, they're showing empathy for their friend Job, who's been hit so hard, and then they root it all by opening their mouths. The gist of what they say to Job is this. Now, let's say this, they're good friends, but they're terrible theologians, terrible theology. They say to Job, you know, Job, here's the deal. If you're good, God blesses you, because God blesses the good. But if you're bad, God blesses the bad, and you have been hit so hard, you must have been so bad. So whatever you did that was so terrible, just repent, confess it, get rid of it, and maybe this will all go away. Well, what are we seeing here? We're seeing a lot of things. First, we're seeing the old moral game. Again, talked about it before. The old moral game. If I'm good, God will be good. The better I am, the more I'm blessed, the better things will be in my life. Kind of a tit-for-tat religion thing. Or else maybe we're seeing this. Maybe we're seeing this whole idea that maybe God really is kind of weak. And you can't really stop uncontrollable forces from coming into the lives of his people if they suffer. Maybe he can't do anything. Or maybe God is strong enough to do something about it. But God is disconnected. He's aloof. He's floating around in heaven. We're struggling it here on earth. Maybe that's what we're seeing. Or maybe, just maybe, it's all random anyway. Does it really matter? Good things happen, bad things happen. What can you do about it? It's just random. It's all chance. All three of these ideas are absolutely unbiblical and absolutely untrue. What Job is modeling for us, Job is modeling. This is why knowing Job, right, the Luther mantra here, read it, meditate it, and then suffer. This is what will draw you closer to God. Knowing Job before you suffer will help you while you suffer. Job is showing us how to suffer in this life. Because the truth is, you may never know why whatever it is happening to you, but you know this. You know that God is good. You know that God is good. You know that God is purposing in the midst of all this suffering that you are enduring, driving him closer to you because he loves you. Job, as far as we know, might not have ever known that directly. Quite possibly, the greatest example of a faithful man to the Lord outside of Jesus stands as a testament. He's the very opposite of what Satan tried to accomplish. Satan tried to accomplish Job, cursing God, throwing God away, and leaving God. Yet Job stands before us thousands of years later. He's a man that trusted God and walked with God and knew God would take care of him in the midst of all this difficulty and all this struggle. Job trusted in the Lord. There's many life lessons. Let's just move through a couple. One of which is simple but incredibly complex. Trust God. Follow God. Surrender to God even when you're suffering. Believe and trust in the truth and the reality of what the scriptures claim to you, that God is good, that God is loving, that he is outside the situation, but he works the situation for your spiritual growth and betterment. The book of Job calls to so many things. The book of Job is screaming out to us, number one, we're not in control. We are not in control even of our own lives. God is in control, and God is outside of our control. From our standpoint, God is completely out of control, and this is good. This is absolutely great. We don't see what God sees. We don't purpose the way God purposes. We don't understand how God understands. But God says that he takes things, and for every one thing, we think, we see God doing, he's doing tens of thousands of things we couldn't even imagine. Another thing that we're seeing is suffering. And I'm not making light about this. Loss of life, the hurt of a loved one, somebody being sick, losing your job, maybe even having some kind of personal identity crisis wherever you are. These things are important. These are important aspects of our life. They're just less important than Jesus. And you'll never lose Jesus. Or how about this? Those things, the pain and suffering in these areas, can't take Jesus from you. The more you hurt on earth doesn't mean Jesus is abandoning you. You're losing your identity doesn't mean you're losing the Savior Jesus. You're struggling with economics or finances doesn't mean Jesus is struggling with you. Oh, you can reject Jesus if you want. You can walk away from him. That's in your power. But these things can't rip Jesus from you. And so we see when our life is built around another person or built around things of this world or built around the approval that people give us, when we suffer, when those things are pruned, when those things are strained, when those things are taken away, we become angry, we become unhappy, we become sad, we can become bitter, totally, totally lost. However, if your life is built around Jesus, if your life is centered in Jesus, when you suffer, all of that will do is drive you deeper and deeper into him, to cling harder and harder to him. Voids that are created by loss are filled with him, and this is exactly what you want. Did Job stumble? Yeah, he did. He's human. Who of us wouldn't stumble? And this is where God gives the response. God says to Job, I couldn't possibly explain myself to you. You could understand that. It's like trying to drain the ocean into a 1 ounce bottle. It's not going to happen. But I want you to know this. I am the loving God who takes care of all things. And he gives that list of incredible animals, incredible situations, and talks about how he controls that and foresees that. Is Job good? Well, the Bible tells us Job is about as good as innocent of man as you can ever find, but he's not perfect. In fact, there truly was the really innocent man. He did come into the world. The truly perfect man did come. And the truly perfect man was assaulted and hit harder than even Job.
And if you look at Job and you think that Job felt abandoned, which you can understand the feeling, the truly innocent man, the son of man, yet son of God, was truly abandoned by God on the cross on Good Friday. He was forsaken. And where Job couldn't do everything that God expects a man to do, Jesus Christ did exactly that. Everything is life in perfect harmony as God had commanded, as God willed with the Father in heaven, all requirements satisfied, and yet Jesus suffered hell for it so we wouldn't. So Job wouldn't. So no people wouldn't. Jesus did it, so we're never forsaken. Jesus did it, so we're never alone. Jesus did it, so we can be with the Father in him through all eternity. In his name we pray. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds set on the one true faith and the life everlasting. Amen.